Well, I think the title is more ambitious than my paper. And it's a very kind of a sketchy outline of a larger project, which is I did an ethnography of the Sindhi tribunal in 2014. I followed it across the country where the tribunal was sitting. And these are just some kind of introductory ideas about thinking about that tribunal. And like my friends before me, I'm going to focus on, therefore, the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, which is the current anti-terror legislation. And as we're all aware, that it was preceded by TADA earlier, and then POTA, which and both TADA was lapsed in 1995 after large-scale outcry that it was a mechanism of persecution, and the latter was also repealed in 2004 after the UPA government came into power, one of its promises being that it would scrap the law in response to similar complaints against it. So while scrapping POTA, there was a simultaneous fortification of UAPA. Many of its provisions absorbed kind of wholesale through amendments into UAPA in 1967. So UAPA is a law which exists prior to both TADA and POTA, which was promulgated in 1967. Fawaz mentioned about the National Integration Council, but that's right, and we also must remember that UAPA was brought into the parliament twice before it was passed. I mean, twice. It was withdrawn because there was a great deal of opposition to it. In 1967 it was passed, and remember that it was in the aftermath of you had the China war, you had the Pakistan war, and you had a kind of internal emergency already in place. One talks about emergency, you know, Indira Gandhi's emergency, but remember that we already had a period of emergency where the Defense of India rules were fortified, and you know, the whole idea of unlawful associationship was already in circulation at that time. Now, both TADA and POTA have received challenges in the Supreme Court, and however, the allegations of these laws suffered from the vice of unconstitutionality in terms of the provisions which attack the fundamental right to fair trial by subverting established evidentiary rules and allowing the admission of confessions, secret witnesses, long detention, etc., were rebuffed in the vice of constitutionality. The Kartar Singh judgment, for example, upheld the constitutionality of TADA, while the Supreme Court asserted that of POTA in the PUCL versus Union of India case. In Kartar Singh, the Supreme Court affirmed the constitutional wholesomeness of the Act by introducing some safeguards in the recording of confessions and by recommending a quarterly review of cases. The adoption of these safeguards as statutory provisions in POTA was hailed as a great advance and testimony to the will of the legislature to ensure a check on the abuse of executive power. However, the gap between the promise of rights and the legal erosion of these rights through these laws was too great to be filled. So what basically we are trying to do is to examine this gap or lag between the formalistic legality of UAPA and its actual effects, which can be patently unlawful or even illegal. And I'm going to look at, as I said, UAPA was amended and provisions of POTA were brought in, but I'm not focusing on the terrorist sections of UAPA, but only looking at the unlawful association section, which is section 3. So UAPA, it basically says that an organization can be banned by declaring it as an unlawful association under section 3.1 of the UAPA 1967, and action under this can be taken by the central government for activities or objectives which are secessionist or which are punishable under section 153A, that's promoting enmity between different groups, or 153B, imputations, assertions prejudicial to national integration of the Indian Penal Code. So the Act, the UAPA itself, claims for itself objectivity and due process, unlike TADA and POTA where you had, you know, admission of confessions and so on, or unlike the CLA 1908, which by executive fiat could declare associations as unlawful. So here UAPA says that it is an objective law filled with due process, because the status of a judicial, and it says that there is a, you know, judicial determination which happens alongside the banning, which distinguishes it not only from preventive detention laws, but in fact places it at a plane superior to it. A distinction is drawn by the Supreme Court in the Jamaat-e-Islami case, as you're aware, in 1992, after the demolition of the Babri Masjid, the RSS was banned under this. But simultaneously, for some strange reason, Jamaat-e-Islami was also banned alongside. And the ban on the RSS was lifted almost immediately by the tribunal, whereas the tribunal which adjudicated on the ban on Jamaat-e-Islami upheld the ban. Now, in the Jamaat-e-Islami case, it's interesting that the counsel for the government said that UAPA is a preventive detention law, that it is not a judicial determination of causes for banning it, it is simply a preventive detention law. Now, however, earlier in the V.G. Rao case, as we know, there is a distinction that is made between preventive detention or externment, which rests on suspicion and is perforce anticipatory, and on the other hand, the declaration of an association is unlawful, which could only be grounded in facts capable of objective determination by the court. This is what V.G. Rao lays out. Now, so UAPA claims for itself this kind of status, saying that we are going to judicially determine whether there are grounds to ban an organization. And the provision of the serving of notice specifying the grounds, disclosure of the facts on which they are based, the adjudication of the existence of a sufficient cause by the organization so declared unlawful, hold out the promise of procedural fairness, as well as a guarantee that restrictions imposed under UAPA would be reasonable. In the Jamaat-e-Islami case, for example, the apex court warned that the tribunal is not required to be a mere rubber stamp or give an imprimatur or the opinion already formed by the central government. So what I propose to do in the next 15-20 minutes is to look at really the way in which the tribunals work. We've already seen how it works in terms of on ground, in terms of the trial, pre-trial and post-trial. So I'm going to just focus on the tribunal aspect and looking at the tribunal in the Simi case. Though there are about 10 or 11 organizations which are banned under UAPA as unlawful associations, but there are very few organizations which actually contest the ban. And Simi is one of the organizations which has consistently contested the ban. Now the first question, and I'm going to focus on maybe two or three points because there's not much time. The first question that I'd like to focus on is the question of locus. Now one of the touchstones of procedural fairness of banning an organization under UAPA is said to be the opportunity given to the banned organization to demonstrate its lawfulness and challenge its proscription under Section 4. But how does an organization which is outlawed and criminalized represent itself before the might of law? Under the circumstances that an organization remains proscribed almost continuously, as has been Simi, the very act of challenging the ban, as its former office bearers have, turns into proof of the continuance of the unlawful organization. And you know, every time there's this kind of cat and mouse game before the tribunal that, oh, can the lawyer representing Simi actually challenge, contest the ban or not? It's always, the question of locus is always, contested. And this time in 2014, when the locus was actually granted, even though the ban was upheld, the lawyer for Simi said, oh, it's a great stride forward because we've been granted locus after, 10 or 12 years of contesting the ban. So for example, in 2006, the tribunal noted that Sri Shahid Badr Falahi was contesting the ban on behalf of Simi. In his cross-examination stated that he took upon himself to contest the present ban in spite of having ceased to be its All India president, as the show cause notice issued by this tribunal was served on him. Of course, a notice was served on him at his address, but it was not in his individual capacity. It was a notice issued to the respondent association, which was to be got served through its office bearers, including Sri Shahid Badr Falahi, who happened to be its All India president at the time of its first ban in 2001. If Sri Badr Falahi had ceased to be the member of the respondent association by virtue of having crossed the age limit of 30 years, it was not obligatory on his part to appear to contest the present ban on behalf of the respondent association. Not only that, he decided to contest the present ban against the association in his individual capacity, he is also found to have been at pains to issue a press release on behalf of it. And it talks about, in what capacity did he take upon himself to issue a press release and so on. Now, it's a long quote, I won't go into all of it, but it concludes, the tribunal concludes, says that one really wonders if Sri Shahid Badr Falahi has ceased to have any connection with the respondent association by virtue of his ceasing to be a member or office bearer thereof. Why is he taking so much interest in defending the respondent organization? From the statement of Sri Falahi in the course of his cross-examination, it does appear that he continues to hold the reins of the respondent organization in spite of having crossed the age limit for its membership. So now, though the 2006 tribunal did not deprive Falahi of his locus to challenge the ban, it did underline the vulnerability of those challenging the ban, exposing themselves to the possibility of being prosecuted for continuing the activities of an unlawful organization under Section 10A. Now, on the contrary, Falahi's contention in the tribunal that Simi had ceased to exist after the ban led to the state objecting to his very participation in the tribunal in 2008 on grounds that he was neither the office bearer of the association nor its member in view of the statement that he's made before the tribunal. It urged, therefore, that Mr. Raja, that is, the lawyer Jawahar, has no locus standi to contest the prohibition or to cross-examine the witnesses. So, though this tribunal magnanimously sort of permitted Falahi to participate in the proceedings in the interests of justice, the 2012 tribunal concurred with the ASG, the State's Council, that individuals who may have had an association with the banned organization earlier and have since ceased to be associated or claim to have detached themselves from the association cannot be permitted to be represented in these proceedings. Now, so this renders the association in many ways unrepresentable. The unrepresentability of the banned organization is reiterated in many, many ways. For example, notices of banning were served on the organization as recorded in orders of the successive tribunals at its head office in Zakir Nagar in Delhi. One may note here that the head office was raided and sealed before these notices were served. So it's kind of a charade playing out. You've already sealed and banned, closed the office, and yet, the notices are being served there. Now, in contrast with the reluctance of the state to allow erstwhile members of the organization to challenge the ban in the tribunal, notices have been served to several people at their addresses to appear before the tribunal if they wish to challenge the ban. Indeed, the 2014 tribunal noted that it has received a number of representations claiming that notices issued to them should not have been issued, as they were neither members of SIMI nor were they involved in any of their activities, and that no case had been registered against them. So, on the one hand, not allowing the members to challenge the ban, and on the other hand, serving notices onto others. Now, the second point that I wish to talk about a little bit is the grounds for notification, because the whole idea is that, it is all very, it's not arbitrary executive fiat, it's all very, there are first facts, and then on the basis of those facts are the grounds, and on the basis of the ground, the notification is served, and the organization is asked to show cause. Now, the bulk of the grounds for notification through the years have been very vague accusations, such as, and I quote, SIMI members have been conducting meetings and giving inflammatory speeches. This is the 2006 notification. In 2012, for example, the notification says they have been radicalizing, brainwashing the minds and indoctrination of Muslim youth by jihadi propaganda and through provocative takreers, that is lectures or speeches, through CDs, etc. Now, in 2014, it says that they have been holding meetings, including secret meetings, making secret meetings or making strategies to induct new members, discussing and raising funds, liaising with like-minded organizations like Popular Front of India and Hizb ut-Tehreek. Popular Front of India is not banned as of now. Now, these allegations lack the tangibility that could invite a rebuttal on facts, the sacred benchmark of the Act's reasonableness. Insofar as actual criminal cases are concerned, the basis for alleging these to be crimes of SIMI are the confessions under 161 CRPC, otherwise meaningless in a criminal trial, where accused confess to the police their continuing membership of SIMI. Now, the admittance of confessions as evidence of SIMI's existence, now as a clandestine underground organization, including indulging in acts of terror, has been challenged consistently in every tribunal, as has been the slipping in of sealed and secret material presented in almost every sitting of the tribunal as conclusive proof of the robust pace of the anti-national activities of the organization. And this I noticed, in the tribunal, every single sitting of the tribunal, there would be, a home ministry guy coming in with huge sealed packets, slipping them to the, judge who was overseeing the tribunal, and of course the counsel for the organization had no access to the secret sealed material. So it's been challenged every time, but these challenges now bear the character and feel of a ritualized drama whose conclusion is predetermined and scripted. The tribunal admittedly is not a criminal trial, but a civil one, where the rules of evidence are to be followed as far as practicable, rendering the Indian Evidence Act inapplicable, stricto sensu. From the first tribunal onwards, it has been the cardinal principle that since the tribunal is not a criminal trial against the accused person, but merely a civil adjudication to determine whether the organization was unlawful in its objectives and activities, the use of confessions would not be hit by Section 25 of the Indian Evidence Act, which prohibits custodial confessions from entering evidence. So Jamaat-e-Islami too carved out an exception within the due process, which it had glowingly upheld by cautioning that requirements of natural justice should be tempered when the public interest so requires. It thus stamped its approval on withholding sensitive information from the association and its members challenging the ban. The point that Professor Bakshi was making yesterday about whether states are beleaguered or strong, I think it's the simultaneous invocation of both strength and weakness, that, oh, we are beleaguered, we are besieged, and so therefore we need to be, have these kind of strong measures to counter that. So that comes across very clearly, especially whole, you know, secret material that's been out there. So, in I'll just kind of skip on that. Now, in 2014, upholding the ban, yet again, the tribunal conceded that there may be defects, incoherency, contradictions, and procedural irregularities during the recording of these statements, that is, confessions, which may prove fatal during the trial when placed under the Scanner of Indian Evidence Act. But the confessions cannot be ignored for the purpose of determining the sufficiency of cause. So what is inapplicable in a criminal trial is allowed to enter into this to determine, you know, the sufficiency of cause of banning the organization. Now, very lastly, I have to say that what interests me here is not simply the bending of evidentiary rules in the tribunal as much as the effects that such a long-term ban and criminalization of an organization like SIMI may have on the criminal trials itself. And I could go on and on and on about these cases, you know, but just to give one or two examples maybe. So what happens is that there is a kind of symbiosis between the ban and the registering of cases. And I'm going to just quote one. I'll finish. And, you know, in one of the cases, for example, from Madhya Pradesh in Pitampur, where you know, about 10 or 12 arrests were made by the, you know, the local police, and we set up this big busting of the SIMI module there. Now, immediately after these arrests were made, the senior superintendent of police of Dhar shot off letters to various districts in Madhya Pradesh asking for registration of similar cases across the these districts. Now, these letters immediately set off a chain reaction, resulting in 18 cases within 1 month and another 4 over the next 6 months. This surely must have been a kind of a sort of report of sorts. How can we be sure that it was the SSP's letters that produced this result? Not only do some of these cases so registered make an explicit reference to this letter, for example, you know, there are various FIRs that one can refer to, but the investigating officer of the case, BPS Parihar, himself produced 18 of these letters in the SIMI UAPA tribunal in 2010. So you have this on the one hand, the continuation of the ban based on these continuing registration of FIRs and the, you know, and the cases being decided then. You know, Kuva spoke about acquittals, but, you know, in many places outside the, you know, glare of media and civil society activists, you actually get a high rate of conviction in these cases. For example, in the Pitampur case where recoveries had been shown from one person and the recoveries were challenged by the accused, and I'm quoting the court, the court says that nothing documentary has been placed before it to prove their guilt. However, this does not have an adverse impact because it is not usually possible to find such proof. One cannot, in fact, expect or desire formal proof. This is the Sessions Court convicting somebody under UAPA. So, I mean, the desire for proof has already been thrown out of the window as well. And just to give one last example of the way in which UAPA works is that when the notification or the grounds of notification are produced, you have, you know, this whole thing about how the banned organization is continuing its activities, and it always, the notification always gives this long list of overground organizations which are acting as front for SIMI. So you have all kinds of organizations, including many non-existent ones, because we try to trace many of these organizations. They did not exist at all, but it was sufficient that they had Muslim sounding names, but also many organizations which are perfectly legal, the Khairi Ummat Trust, which is a charitable trust, Popular Front of India, which is not as of now banned, but which could be banned any day. The Minority Rights Watch, for example. So you create this whole jurisdiction of suspicion and dangerousness, and anybody who gets attached to that, you know, kind of is enfolded into that, you know, regime of suspicion. So I would just end here by saying that though it pretends to be, you know, to be imbued with procedural fairness and not like a preventive detention act, UAPA actually ends up being, you know, like a preventive detention act. Thank you.
Thanks.